Serge, if you don't mind, we're going to be recording this presentation so we can put it on our website. And if you have a problem with that, you know, just let us know. It is my pleasure to introduce today Serge Petiton. He's a professor at the University of Lille in France, and he has a CNRS senior position at the Maison de la Simulation in Paris-Saclay. He holds a PhD in computer science and has done his habilitation at the Sorbonne University, Pierre Marie Curie campus. Serge Petiton has supervised more than 25 PhD students and has offered more than 140 articles in international journals, books, and conferences. He has a large number of international collaborations, and we're hoping that you'll be collaborating with us as well. His main current research interests are in parallel and distributed computing, post petascale dense and sparse linear algebra, language and programming paradigms for extreme modern scientific computing and machine learning. So today I'm very pleased to have you here, Serge, with us. We're hoping that it would have been in person, but it's good to see you nonetheless. And we're very interested in hearing about YML and multi-level programming paradigms using graphs of tasks. Welcome.
Okay, thank you, Eva, for this introduction. Yes, it's a pity that we was not able to visit you, but I hope we'll be able to do that as soon as possible. So the NAID and myself research since many years are mainly on HPC and very large linear algebra managed using very large sparse matrices and so on. And since more than about 22 years ago, we launched this YML project to be able to deploy our research algorithms and different methods and peer-to-peer platform, grid, and large supercomputer. So today I will try to summarize and introduce the main concepts of YML. So this work was done with a lot of colleagues, which are now in different parts in the world, in different associations. So after a very short introduction, I will mainly introduce the idea of graph of parallel tasks. I assume many of you with Eva on the Eva teams know already that, but I will try to summarize rapidly. I will after introduce the main idea of YML and also YML XMP. And after, I will give you an example with the blog Gojourd on how we can use YML to develop that. So as an introduction, the main idea is to be able to do distributed and parallel computing. And so you know that for the future exascale or the post-petascale computing, even the supercomputer now is more distributed on parallel platform than just a classical parallel computer as in the past. So we have a lot of problems. Of course, we need to minimize the global computing time. We have to accelerate the convergence, but mainly you have to minimize the communication. So minimizing the communication when you have a very large number of cores or computing unit is to avoid a large reduction with addition or scalar product between along all the cores. So the idea will be to have more partial reduction with addition or global operation with subset of cores. So the idea is to have a few tasks in parallel and to have the reduction on the computation inside the communication inside the subset of cores. So the idea to have some tasks instead to have just one computation along all the cores to have several communication. And of course it will be a few tasks in parallel with large granularity. So is mainly the idea we had at the beginning to try to minimize the communication along all the cores. And also the idea to have a nice, better scheduling and more asynchronously, more asynchronous computation. So it was the idea at the beginning of to use this kind of programming. And if you look about the problem we expect to have for exascale computing, it's approximately the same kind of challenges. So the main idea is to use a graph of tasks, but here is really large granularity task, of course. So of course, it exists a few languages where you can have this kind of programming. And if you're interested, we have a few papers when we compare with a few of these, especially with HPX and Regent. But today I will mostly focus on YML. So the idea is to, as I said, to minimize the global communication along all the cores or all the computing units of a very large supercomputing platform. Because of course the latency between Fares cores are most very expensive, and we want to avoid that. So the idea is really to have a graph of large granularity tasks, and I will present you our idea to do that. And the main idea is really to see that to realize that supercomputers now are more distributed on parallel computer. If you look at the very, very large supercomputer, you have a rack. On the rack, you have a lot of board with processor. And if you look at the distance between one rack and the other one, is more distributed computing than classical parallel computing as we had in the past. And of course, the idea is to have something which allow to have asynchronous scheduling, asynchronous computation, and with some smart scheduling to be able to optimize data movement and the communication. Of course, the existing supercomputers don't have any smart scheduling. So we try to find some way to do that with the existing supercomputer. So the idea of a graph of task, of course, you know the idea. You have some task, and you have to define the control flow, the graph of task. So usually, many languages allow to directly describe the control graph. That means you need to finish this task before to begin this one and so on. It exists some other language where you define the data flow instead of the graph, the control graph. But so the problem is when you, if you have just this graph, it's not enough to have a smart scheduling and nice graph of task programming. Because if you look about, you need to have both the graph of task and the graph of data, the control flow and the data flow. Because for example, here you have one task which generates one data. And this data will be consumed, for example, by this task. And so if you have this information, you can pre-schedule where this task will be allocated. And so you can anticipate the data migration. That means as soon as this data is generated by this task, you can already send this data to the processor or the node which will consume this data. And during, so you will have all this computation. And so when you re-begin this computation, this data will be already available. So this kind of data anticipation or data migration is very important for this kind of programming. And so to be able to do that, you need to have both the graph of the control graph and the data flow graph. It's very important. And so it's the same even if you have some fork join, very classical fork join. If you compute that in parallel, after you will have to compute that, and during this time, you will be able to anticipate the data migration and to send this data where it will be consumed here, for example. So like this, you can overlap communication and computation, which is very important. So we assume that we want to have a programming using graph of task on a language or a framework, a programming paradigm, which allow you to the scheduler will be able to have both the control flow and the data flow to be able to optimize it. So YAML was launched with this kind of idea 22 years ago, approximately. So it's an open source, so you can find everything on this website. So it exists also a Docker, which is improving these days, and so it's possible it will be soon optimized to be able to deploy YAML very easily. And so the idea is to have a high-level graph description language. So I will introduce the main idea of this language called EVET, which have LL1 grammar, so very easy to parse. And the idea is, of course, the language need to be completely independent of the middleware, the hardware, and the library. So we have a front-end and a back-end. And so we need the front-end, of course, will be independent of any of the middleware, hardware, and so on. And we need to develop a backend for each middleware. So on the past, we developed one backend for Extreme Web, which was a peer-to-peer middleware developed by Frank Capello at INRIA. So working with him, we deploy YAML on the large peer-to-peer platform. And we use another backend with OmniRPC, which is a middleware developed in Japan by Sato-san team in Riken, first in Tsukuba and after in Riken. And we also have a backend using both ExtremeWeb and OmniRPC, which means we was able to deploy tasks on the two middleware. The idea also is something to have something where which allow the end user to give some expertise, because we think that the end user, if we get expertise from the end user, it's very interesting to have an access scheduling. And of course, the idea is to be able to use existing library and software. So it was in 22 years, it was deployed in many, many different platforms, including the K computer. I will show you some results on the K computer, but also on T2K and also in Hooper, in LBNL, on different platforms. And we also did some experiments on a very large peer-to-peer platform. So the main idea, we'll have a graph of tasks, or for each task, each node of the graph, which is a task in this case, we'll have several components. We'll have an abstract component which describes what the task is doing, or just what the task is doing, not the algorithm, just what the task is doing, and what data is in, out, or in, out. Of course, I will give you soon some example. We have an implementation component. That means we have different components in different languages, Fortran, C, C++, XMP, or other PGAS languages. Or for one abstract component, we, of course, may have several implementation components. And we have a graph component which describes the graph of task itself. And of course, as I said, the name of this language is EVET, is a river in Saclay. In USA, in the past, we have computer. We take the name of subway station at the red line in Cambridge, like Condell Square, and so we prefer to take the name of the river. We think it was more poetical. So anyway, we have a few in the language. We are able to define to use some parallel section. So we have some key parallel and par, and all the sections are separated by this. And all the section will be in parallel. We have sequential loop, parallel loop. Of course, I will give you an example. And we have the synchronization between tasks working on different parallel branch are with waiting on an event or notifying an event. So I will give you an example. And here it's an example. So of course, I have just a 2D graph, but it can be n-dimension graph. And the idea also is the possibility that one task can be itself a graph. We didn't implement that for problem of time, but it's the idea that one task can be a graph of task is something which is possible on the language. So the program here is not associated with the graph. So here, for example, we have this can be done in parallel of this, can be done in parallel of this and this. And here we have a parallel loop. But of course, when I say can be done in parallel, after you have to respect the dependency. For example, here you begin to compute this task and unify this event. And after here, you can start also unify this event. And after, of course, we have to wait. So we can begin this parallel loop just after having notified this and this. And also we have the keyword compute because we want to be allowed to give a very general workflow. So we can also specify some data migration, some visualization of our data in parallel of the computation. So here, for example, after this, I wait on this event and waiting here. And after when I finish, I can beginning this loop. I have the possibility to have also some array section, of course, to wait with an array of events. So like this, you can specify any graph. It was demonstrated that this kind of language allow you to describe a graph as powerful as PetriNet or something like that. So you can specify very, very general graph. And for an end user, because we really focus the end user, for the end user, it's not too complicated to specify that. Of course, each task can be a very large program because we assume that we have a large granularity programming. So here can be a very large program and some part of libraries. So as I said, for one task here, we have a few components. So one is the abstract component. So the abstract component, you have the name. And after, mainly, you have the type of the data, and if the data in is in out or out. And so it's important because independent, if you have just the event program, if you have just the graph of task plus the abstract component, it's very easy to generate the data flow graph. So that means with the event language, you have the control flow graph, the control flow. And with this abstract component, it's very easy to generate the data flow. So like this, without any programming of any task, you can already analyze the control flow and the data flow and to pre-schedule this. So of course, on one abstract component, you can have several implementation components. And so here you have to specify the language and after a few different information. And here we allow, because it's encapsulated with XML component, we allow the end user to add a few information. And it will be very important when we will use XMP because we will have to give some information about the template and the distribution. And here is one way for the end user to give some expertise or some semantic information. In the future, we can also assume that the end user can choose between different arithmetic or so on. And after, you have the graph component, so using EVET. So here, it's just a part of one EVET. So you have, of course, again, encapsulated with XML. So it's a graph. So you have different information, and low you see you have a parallel loop. And after you see that you wait on some events. And here, for example, you see that you unify an event of with three different dimensions. And you will see that for the block Gauss-Jordan, the graph is a 3D graph, the dependency graph. And so like this, you can notify the event, and you are waiting on this event on every other part of the program. For example, here you are waiting on different events. So like this, with these three different kind of components, can have a very general framework to do some distributed computation, as I explained. So here is the YML. So in blue is a front end. Here it's a back end. So you need to have a back end, of course, depending of the middleware of the you are using and depending of the computer, the platform you are using. First, you generate some components. So you have a development catalog with a different kind of component. After, you will generate a binary depending your computer, your platform, on your backend. And you will analyze the workflow. So you have the graph component here. You analyze the workflow and you pre-schedule and so on. And after, you have, for the moment, it's very easy scheduler because the middleware, the scheduler at the middleware level are very poor for the moment. So we lose some information sometime from ear to ear, because here we can sometime have very some interesting pre-scheduling that we are not always able to exploit here. And after, we send the information to the backend, which launch in parallel a few different tasks. And the data movement are directly from the, after it depends on the backend, but the idea is to have directly the data movement between the different worker and the data repository. So the example I will give you is, the idea is really to have a hierarchy of programming, because now all the new platforms, the new supercomputer, you have a very high hierarchy of programming paradigms. You have a very large granularity. After, you have at the rack level, at the board level, at the processor level. Inside the processor now, you have a few other levels of programming with the cores or the network on chip. And so the idea is to mix several levels of a few different programming paradigms. So today I will focus on YML plus XMP. And in more general, we are proposing YML with task using PGAS language, because we think it's really one of the best solutions. And so XMP is it's some slide from Sato-san. So the idea is very classical. We have to develop. You specify the number of nodes, the template, how the template is used. So here it's a block, but it can be cyclic. So you will have some block distributed along the different nodes. And after, you align, very classical, you align the data on the template, and you distribute the template as it's defined. So here it's a very easy example, thanks to Sato-san slide. And so you just an example. So here you align a row of the array and one element of the template. And after, you can specify the different language. So it exists a few PGAS language, but as we work mainly on K computer with OmniRPC, because to work on a supercomputer, you need to deploy a middleware. And so the Japanese colleague developed OmniRPC on the top of the K computer. So we was able to do some scheduling on the top of the processor on the K. And here, for, as I said, on the implementation level, we can add some information. And here, for XMP, it's interesting because we need to add some information about the alignment and about the template, because for XMP, we need to have this kind of information. So after, here, just a very easy example. So it's a block ELU, but just an example. So here we have an abstract component. So we just define it's a product matrix, and it's two matrix are in, one is out. And here it's XMP, it's a graph, it's a event. So here with the abstract on the event program, it's independent of any implementation on any language used to run on the task. And here you have each task is an XMP task. Okay, and here is really the event program, and here it's the implementation component for XMP. So it's I will give you the slide, and we have paper if you want more detail. So the general idea is really to have a multi-level programming. So here, using YML, we have the graph of tasks. Of course, it's not 2D, it can be n dimension. Each task, it's a parallel task using, in this case, X and P. And we assume also that each node is really can be also used multi-threading over another level of programming. We did in the past with the collaboration with Japan, we did an experiment with YML XMP plus StarPU. This means that in one node we use StarPU, so we have three levels of programming. So it works, we had good results. But honestly, it's not so easy because all these languages are still not so stable, and we have to use the middleware on the top of the computer. So it works, it was magic in one way because it was quite complicated. But the idea in the future is really to have several levels of parallelism with different programming paradigms. And so we think that YML will be on the top. And after that, we will have PGAS for each task plus a few other levels of programming. So how it was developed on the K computer? So we, as I said, our colleagues Japanese deploy OmniRPC on the top of MPI on the top of the K computer. So we launch YML scheduler and one node. And we launch after one OmniRPC agent. And during this, the scheduling was analyzed here for one, we analyze the graph. And after they send a request to OmniRPC to deploy some task. And after OmniRPC launch in the several node of K in parallel a task. Of course, it was more than three. It was just an example. During this time, in parallel, of course, the scheduler was working, and he sent a request for another task, and so on, with respect of the graph. So, of course, it can be improved in the future with more smarter scheduling. But still, it was interesting to demonstrate that on a supercomputer, if we have a middleware, we can already do some distributed and parallel computing on a computer like the K. So we did on the past with a very large platform with peer-to-peer. We launched some application. It was about more than 20 years ago, perhaps more from INRIA booth in supercomputing. The scheduler was in Lille, and we use Antoine of PCs in universities in France, and we use four clusters in Tsukuba, and it works. It works. Of course, the performance was not the same as a supercomputer. It was more peer-to-peer approach, but it works. And we also work on other platforms like GRID 5000. It's a very large platform for research in distributed computing in France. So we deploy YML on this kind of platform with the same idea. And we use different computers, including Hooper in LBNL. So now I will give you very rapidly an example. We did a lot of more experiment with different more, including some geoscience application using from Total and so on the page one. But I will just focus on one application, one method, which is the block closure down method. So not entering in detail, the idea is to invert a matrix. And so we compute a matrix B, such as AB equal the identity, so B will be in the invert. So it's not really a theoretical method. It's really, this method is quite used in the industry for real application. So I will show you on the matrix how it works rapidly. So first we have one task, we invert a block. Before that, of course, we need to load this data. And after, all the task number two need to have the result of this task. And this task needs to have this as an input. So is why I have here some connection. So all the number two need to have the result of the task number one plus this data as an input. This one have no input for the beginning. And after all the data, all the tasks of one column need to have the result of this one to have the value of this of the original matrix plus this element. So that means each element need to have his own data, is as an input of this block, the result on this one, on this data. So that means that you see we need the, we can anticipate the data migration when we are doing this task. We can anticipate, we can already, for example, if we look about this task, we can already store a load of this data plus this one. And when we finish this one or we finish this one, when we have to begin to launch this task, with this kind of anticipation of migration data, we already have this data available on the process, on the where this type will be computed. So I know I would like to give you the main idea, okay, because I don't have time to enter more in details, but the idea is we have this kind of computation. So that means we have three levels of tasks, one, two, or three. And we need to finish one to begin number two, and we need to finish two before to begin number task number three, with label three. And we have also some data dependency. And with YML and the abstract components, the scheduler can have both the data and the control flow. And for the second step, we have the same kind of computation, except that is different. But of course, this matrix is never stored on a. It's just some blocks who are distributed on a different different node, and which exchange data. This matrix is never exist except perhaps in some disk, but. When we are on the parallel computer, it's just some block we are communicate between different parts of the supercomputer or the platform. And we can remark something interesting. This task, as soon as we finish this one at this step, we can begin this one at the second step. So even the dependency, the sequentiality between the step are not necessary. So that means we have a 3D dependency graph. I know that I go a little fast, but just to give you the main idea, you have to have an idea of the kind of dependency. That means that we can begin this start. Computation can be begin as soon as this one is finished on the first step, even if other tasks are not finished. So that means we really have a 3D graph of dependency. And so we can optimize after what you call data persistency. That means that the computation which are beginning here, before we don't have any computation to compute this block. After we have some computation, so of course, we'll allocate this computation on the same peer, on the same part of the computer or peer, which generate this result for the step before. Like this, we have some data dependency and we don't have to send this data on some part where this task will be computed. Okay, so just I tried to explain you that we have a 3D graph, we have some data exchange. And if we do some anticipation of data migration plus data persistency, we can optimize a lot of communication. And to do that, you just need to have the data flow plus the data flow plus a kind of smart scheduling to be able to do that. Of course, if you use just MPI or classical language, it's not possible to have this 3D graph and to have all this asynchronous scheduling and all this kind of data movement optimization. Here is just an example of the allocation of the task. And here is just an example for the when we for the second step, but just when we have a sequentiality between the step, because otherwise it's too complicated to present on a slide if we don't have any sequentiality between the steps. Of course, at the end, I explain on the matrix, but at the end, the matrix never exists on the computer. At the end, you just have some tasks. So here is the task number one, here is the task label number two, and here's the task number three. And here in black is the control, is really the control flow dependency. Really, it's some, and here is the data dependency between two steps of the method. And one of the dependency is communication. And so is data flow. And so if we use, if we have a good scheduling with data dependence, persistency and anticipation of data migration, those communication are completely overlapped by the computation. So it's something that we remark on, which is very important to minimize the cost of the communication. So here is not the block goes Jordan, it's just block because otherwise it's too, the graph is too complex to show on a slide. But here it's just for Gauss, because here I show you something very regular, but at the end, it of course is not as regular. I said you that we can have some tasks from different steps working together, so it's in parallel. So it's never as beautiful like this. So in general, the graph is like this. So, but it's just for Gauss. I mean, it's not, it's very similar to the Gauss-Jordan to invert matrix. But so you see, we have different kind of tasks with the color. And at the end, you just need to respect some flow, and you are never something so regular like that. So after is the scheduling. And using YML, you can describe all this graph and describe the to have parallelism and using PGAS for each. So here it was the Gauss for linear system. Here is Gauss-Jordan, but to solve a linear system, not to invert a matrix, which is already quite complex. Of course, here is just an example. In blue is some task of the second step which are finished. In red is some task on the second step which are not finished. But still, if we have tasks which are not finished on the second step, we can launch some task associated to the third step of the method. That means it's really a 3D graph, and we need to be able to have languages and to have programming paradigm which allow to exploit this asynchronous. So here is some result obtained on the K computer. So of course we have a lot of parameters here, okay? We have here, because we need to know how many blocks we use for the matrix. So here is the number of blocks. Okay, so here, for example, is the result if we have a 2x2. Okay, here is the, in this color is the result if we have 8x8. And here we always use up to 8,000 processor of K computer. And so here is the number of processor for each task. So that means here, for example, which is the best result, we have 8x8 blocks for the matrix, and we use 1,000 processor for each task. That means we can have 8 tasks in parallel. So here is if we use in green, for example, it will be 4x4, and here we'll use 512 processor for one task. So we saw that, of course, some results are very, you need to find something which is well adapted to your middleware and your platform. The best is where you have 8x8 block, and when you use 1,000 nodes for one task. And here is the result if you use just XMP. Because the interest here, of course, is to compare XMP with YML plus XMP to see the impact of YML. And here it was on this work was done was run by people from RIKEN, so it was not the YML team in one way who did work that. And so we saw that we have quite better result using YML plus XMP than just XMP. So it depends of many parameters. Here it was this kind of matrix, of course. In the future, we'll have more larger matrix and same thing. So if you look now at just solving a block linear system, we compare YML XMP plus XMP again. So of course, the best is to compare YML XMP plus XMP because we use the same Omni RPC and the same middleware. Oh no, sorry, with XMP, you don't use Omni RPC, but here we use YML Omni RPC plus XMP. So here is the size of the matrix. Here is the blocks. Here it's the number of cores. So we have more result, of course, but I just show you today this result. Again, using this number of processor. And you can see that we have better result using YML with XMP instead of XMP. Of course, it's better when you have large matrices. So the result can be quite interesting. After we compare on Poincaré, which was a cluster of IBM Power in Paris-Saclay Maison de Simulation. So we compare also with MPI, ScalaPack, which is the most famous library for this kind of application. So of course, here is a smaller matrices, okay? And so sometimes we can have here, for example, we have better results at XMP. And it can change a lot depending of several criteria. Here, for example, the result is better, but after it's very difficult to analyze. So as soon as you change the computer, you change the network because here the network is not like on the K computer. K computer is a six-dimension network. Here it's another network. And anyway, it's always difficult to have a general conclusion. But for many applications, YML XMP can be very more interesting than XMP. And sometimes MPI is better, but because anyway, we are on the top of MPI. And again, we have to put a middleware on the supercomputer to be able to do that. So in the future, and many constructors are aware of that, but as the end user are not already asking for that, we need to have smarter scheduler to be able to directly have the scheduler optimized for the supercomputer, not on the top, because here OmniRPC, it's on the top of OmniMPI and so on. And also we have a fault tolerant version. You know, for Exascale, we have problem with fault tolerances and energy consumption plus all the other problem. So we develop a fault tolerant version. Well, mainly Miwako and the Japanese colleague developed this version, but we work with them. So we have, with this kind of smart scheduling, it's not so difficult to do some fault tolerances because you just need to relaunch launch again a task to attribute the computation to another part of the supercomputer or another peer. But of course, you need to save some data as soon as the task is not finished. But at the end, it's not too complicated. And the overhead is about 5% to 2.3%. I mean, if you don't have any fault, the overhead of the system is acceptable. And if you have some fault, it depends between 10%, 25%. It depends, of course, of the platform, if the task you have to launch again, the data. But so it's very easy to have. And if you have just an MPI program using a very, very large computer, if you have a fault, you need to, everything. And if you need to have checkpointing, the energy consumption of just one checkpointing for a whole system is very expensive. So like this, you can avoid to have a general checkpointing. So as a conclusion, so I know I just give you the main idea. I wanted to summarize a few concepts and give you some examples, but I know if you have more questions or if you want more details, I can send you a PhD dissertation or paper. Okay, so the idea was really to propose a high-level programming paradigm with the idea of multi-level programming to have always the data flow and the control flow. Okay, and for the new post-petascale computer on the future now and for future exascale computer, if we are able to have a smart scheduler, it can be is one solution. And also something interesting is the same program, the same YML program with the same abstract component, even the same implementation can work on the peer-to-peer platform also. You have just to change the backend, of course. So you think it's available with some papers and some tutorials on this website. And so I forgot to say, but of course, this was done with a lot of colleagues from Japan, and it was part of a large project supported by SpecSAC, which was a German managed project, and we had a German, Japanese, French project to work on that. So with the colleague from RWTH in Haren, we also work on the correctness of part of this YML XMP programming paradigms, and there are papers and a book was published about the result from a SEXPA. So I will stop here. If you have any question or comments, I'm available.
Thank you very much, Serge. So other questions for Serge? See Loïc.
Yeah, I do have some questions. So thanks, Serge, for the talk. So I have actually two questions. The first one would be, so now you have more and more GPUs on supercomputers. So did you start to integrate GPUs in YML, or is it already done? Or
well, the GPU will not be integrated at the YML level. It's integrated inside the task. Okay. So the main idea, of course, is to if you want to use GPU, you have to use an implementation component. A program where you will have some CUDA or asking some libraries from NVIDIA or something like that. As I said, we already have in the past also StarPU inside one task. So inside one task, you can after run with GPU. So I'm not sure we already did that. Naïd, do you know if we already had some task with some GPU? I'm not sure.
No, we didn't use CUDA for the moment, but you know, we implicitly use GPU with the kind of data parallel programming. You know, this kind of programming, this programming model is possible with YML inside one task or sometimes between tasks, but in general is inside one task.
Yes, GPU will be as StarPU managed in one task, because here we use PGAS. So with PGAS, if you use GPU, you don't solve the GPU. It's the idea of PGAS. You use global array. So if you use global array, after you can have GPU and so on. But at the end, you can also, if you want, explicitly in one task use GPU or other kind of accelerators or something like that. Yeah. You have a second question?
Yes. So my second question is like more obvious. It's more like Did you think to integrate YML with like some scientific workflow management system? Obviously Pegasus, but like some other, because you talk about multiple levels. So I guess the like to add another level, which would be a WMS. So you can run YML on multiple supercomputers at the same time and manage, you know, data movements between supercomputers or between cloud and supercomputers or.
Yeah, of course. Of course. One of my former students now, Maxime Hugues, who work a lot with us, is now working in Amazon in US. And so I discuss, we have a lot of possibilities like this. And of course, with Pegasus, we was expecting to work with you, and but with all the problems since 2 years, it was quite complicated. But the main idea is to see. And I was also a few years ago working, discussing with some people from UCSD to work something, I don't remember the name, it was an interface which was also with graph.
Kepler, probably.
Kepler, something like that, yeah. So, yeah, it exists several ideas. We also experiment and compare with HPX, with Regent, there are a lot of, and in the past I discussed with Miron Livni, he gave us the software for Dagman, and so we wanted to have a backend with Dagman. So of course it exists. The main idea is really, we have the front end. The front end is independent, but after, when you have a backend, you can, as I said, we on the past we did a backend with two middleware, so we deploy depending of the availability of the resource, and of course it's possible to do. And yeah, of course to I think Pegasus, yeah, is quite, there are some similarity and there are some possibility to. Yeah, it was the idea anyway. We wanted to do on the past, but.
That sounds great. And, you know, like I was saying, within our group, you know, we'll, you know, discuss a bit more how we could, you know, potentially integrate Pegasus and YML. I think there are some good opportunities there. And then we can schedule another call to discuss in more detail. You know, so you mentioned that we need smarter schedulers. We have the same issue because, especially that, you know, we schedule jobs to these supercomputers from remote locations. So we also have to deal with issues of authentication and all that stuff, which is painful. But why do you think we our schedulers are so dumb? I mean, you know, they haven't really changed in years, right? And
for the moment, many of the supercomputers are just a FIFO. They are just launching some. But something interesting, even in the past with one student, we experiment using just a scheduler of the supercomputer, and just the fact to use YML on the top, to reschedule, we had an acceleration, even if it was just a FIFO, because just the fact to pre-schedule before, we had. But yeah, I discussed with a few constructors, including guy from Fujitsu, and they are aware that they need to improve, but the end user don't ask that now. So they are not developing some smarter scheduler. But so we are obliged now to put ourselves some middleware on the top of MPI, which is really not very efficient. Mm-hmm. And when we did peer-to-peer system, it was a little more interesting because with a peer-to-peer system, you can you do your own scheduling because when you at the peer level, you don't have any scheduling. But of course, it was another idea because the performance was not the same, of course. Mm-hmm. And also, we did something with Total on DDN, Data Direct Network, in the past. We try to dedicate the communication. I mean, we try to prefetch in one way the data from the disk to the computer. and to minimize the I/O and the communication. And to do that, we need to have the data flow. But with the information we had at the YNML level, we didn't interconnect with what we did, but the idea was having data flow on the control graph. You can, if you establish a smart communication between the scheduler and at the computational level with the IO manager at the disk level or data center, you can prefetch the data before they were consumed on another level of memory closer to the computing unit. So there are a lot of potentiality to optimize computation on many data migration, because the data migration also at the energy point of view is more consuming. But the problem is it's difficult because we was very lucky with the Japanese, because they manage the computer, they manage the middleware, and we was able to they manage XMP. So it was very convenient. Is why we was able to work with YML, XMP plus RPU, because otherwise, if you use a general computer like this, it's complicated, very, very complicated.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's great. And, you know, I think so Loic has also been thinking about the energy consumption and being able to provide users with choices of, you know, how they want to run their workflows in a maybe potentially more energy efficient way. So that could be another area of collaboration.
Yeah, because something we did on the past, we decrease the frequency of the processor to save energy, especially if you have something asynchronous. Sometimes the task have to wait of a task, so you can expect and decrease the frequency of the processor, because anyway, they are going too fast. So you decrease the frequency. And we did that for some linear algebra method. And I think we save about, I don't remember, 20% of the energy. But you have to assume that you can have 5-10% the time, the computing time, the global computing time may increase a little. So if the end user accept to have a little increasing of the global time, you can sometime, and it's really, you can imagine to have general system with fault tolerances, with minimizing energy, but at the end you need to have nice middleware and some smart scheduling. But I forget to say on the conclusion, but we also have some evolution with explicit checkpointing and dynamic graph for future version of YML, which will be able to include the main idea also was able to allow the end user to give some expertise. So is why on the implementation level or even at the abstract level, the end user can specify if they allow, if they will accept to increase a little the global time to save energy, and if they want this arithmetic instead of this arithmetic, because now with the mixed arithmetic, and more processor will be 32-bit or 16-bit arithmetic. So for machine learning applications. So it's a very general framework.
Mm-hmm.
Really, when we launched that 22 years ago, it was really because we need to have this kind of thing for our application. So we really think from the end user point of view, and to be able to, since even if at the time it was so classic to use component and things like that, we really tried to have something which was able for us to give more mini information. So. But of course, after you need, it's a lot of work.
Yeah, no, this is great. And actually, interesting enough, Pegasus is about the same age, so 2000, 2001, it became what it is. Well, it started to become what it is today. So Serge, I wanted to thank you so very much for joining us. I'm sorry it's not in person, but I owe you a nice lunch in LA. at least that when you visit. Usually we take the speakers out to lunch, so you have at least one in the bank. And I look very much forward to seeing you in person sometime soon, either in Paris or in LA.
Yeah, we also have a few restaurants in Paris.
Awesome. Sounds great.
Well, I can invite you to discuss. So.
thank you very much. And we're going to have a meeting internally and then also get back to you and discuss some more potential collaborations.
Yeah, no problem. So have a nice day.
Thank you.
Morning for you. And so yeah. I wait for some mail and we organize a meeting. And perhaps after with Naïd, we can also invite other people for the French part.
Yes, that would be great. We have we're hosting a workshop on March 1st and 2nd, but so we'll be back after that.
Okay.
If that's okay. So, expect to hear from us in March.
Okay.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye, Eva. Bye-bye, everybody.